Hey man, good to see you.
Nice to see you, Tom. How's things? Tell me everything.
I love that. I don't know why. Just tell me everything. Let's see. weather's slightly cooling off a little bit, which I like. So that enables us to get out and start doing our walks again, which is really imperative for us as we get older. We put on a little bit of weight here and there. Excuse me. And I know that for me, and for Kira too, it works out well if we watch what we're eating, don't overconsume, don't oversnack, go for walks, long walks on a regular reoccurring basis, and drink water, then we find it easy to maintain health and wellness. And so it's been brutally hot, so we haven't been able to do that for like the past 4.5 months here. So I'm grateful that the weather is such that we can get back to doing that, because it just feels good to be able to go out and do that. And the walks for me are so meditative. I mean, at first, you've got all these thoughts going on, your mind's racing, and you're thinking about work, and you're thinking about, that they're eating the cats and the dogs and all this stuff. And then finally, like, you just get into the rhythm, and you're just focusing on your breathing and your heart rate and your steps and, the breeze and the scenery. And my mind just, it's not like empty, but it's just kind of like clear, and those thoughts are still there, but they're just kind of in the background. And so anytime you can find something that's meditative for you, for me it's harder to just like sit and zone out and just like be in that zen place. I have to be like actively doing something, and in the process of doing something, whether that's a hobby like woodworking or whether that's going for long walks, that's when I find that peaceful place. So maybe that's kind of what we talk about today, is finding some semblance of peace and serenity in your life, because things are chaotic, things are unstable, as we've been talking about the past couple of episodes, and also because of what's happening with politics and stuff going on in the world, that we need to have that sense of peace and serenity to combat the anxiety, stress, confusion, all the things that are going on. So, finding a way to have some peace and serenity through whatever, meditation, through yoga, through reading, through escaping, and even if it's a good show and you're just focused on that show and you can just unwind and let your mind just kind of go, it's really important.
Yeah, I absolutely agree. We talk to people every day about what brings you joy. When is the happiest moments of your day? When is it what parts of the day do you have that you're most at peace? And people have a hard time identifying that. And that's a warning flag right there. If you cannot identify what brings you peace, then you need to be paying more attention to those things, You and I, we talk about it every day, so we have found it in our lives. And there were times in our life where we didn't focus on the joys in our life, that we were so family, business, work, whatever focused. And we had forgotten those things. And we've talked about this, you and I extensively, about those were not the most fun years of our lives. So we have worked on it. We've taken our own personal journeys and worked on it. And I do the same. I walk every day. I walk in the mornings. And I'm back to it. I'm still not pushing weights every morning like I should, but I have a plan to get back to that because that brings me joy. So walking is the same for me. And I listen to music while I'm walking. And I find new music. That's kind of my thing. I'll pick a song out of my playlist, and then I have it set up where it'll build a playlist or find other songs kind of in that genre. And I've found so many great new music that I have never experienced before. And that brings me joy when I can find a new song or a new something. And I go back and forth with my kids about, oh my gosh, I found the song today, check it out. And they do the same for me. So that's kind of a thing for us. And the other thing that I've said before is motorcycles. I got back into motorcycles years ago, and that really brings me joy, is just that ride, the peace, the wind. What do they call it? Wind therapy. I need some breeze on my knees kind of therapy. And Florida is a hard place to ride motorcycles because there's a lot of real crappy drivers here that don't pay attention. But I just head out west. I'll drive out west and to take a back road out to in the middle of nowhere. Set it to drive like a half hour west, and then as soon as I hit that about half hour, then I'll turn around and drive it back. And brings me lots of peace when cars don't fall out in front of me. Then it brings me anger. But fine, we have these conversations. What brings you peace? Tell me about the best parts of your day.
Well, some people find peace if they're close to a body of water where they have saltwater therapy, whether that's being on a boat or a jet ski or surfing or paddleboarding or skimboarding or lazy river somewhere, or being in the pool and just lounging in the pool. That can offer some peace and serenity. Maybe it's the weightlessness, or how it's not taxing on the joints, being in water. Those can be places where you can find some peace and serenity. We don't need to wait until your vacation once a year to have peace and serenity. I mean, I want you to be able to find that each and every day in some fashion, even if it's for 20, 30 minutes, to find something that brings you a sense of peace, and serenity, and maybe even some joy. You need to do that, because what's the point of us going through the daily grind? What's the point of us trying to make money if we can't enjoy it? What's the point of us, just not getting enough sleep and burning the candle at both ends if we don't have those moments on a regular basis where we can really let our hair down, figuratively?
Right, absolutely. The pool is another one for me. I feel at peace just standing in the water. I'm a fire sign, so I think the opposite of fire, the water brings me peace. So it's it's a balance. The other thing is I love fish tanks, right? I love the watching them and the fish and the just the bubbling sound, and it's very peaceful. But I hate spending time maintaining a fish tank. That's not joyful for me at all. So that outweighs the joy that I get, is all the work that comes along with it. So I have an old laptop and I just go to YouTube and I'll pull up an aquarium and I'll just let it sits on one of my t on a table that I have, and I have a fish tank. It's a virtual fish tank, and it provides me peace, but I don't have to clean it.
Well, think about that. That's interesting, because how I think it would be a good practice for you to think about the things that you're doing, and just in the back of your mind, consider, is this causing me more stress, or is this promoting more peace in my life? And I guarantee, if you just have that thought the rest of today, you'll probably find that you're causing yourself more stress, probably undue stress, than you are peace in your life. And we need to change this.
One, that's funny you say that. Does our search for peace bring us misery? I've talked to several people that go camping. They're campers, and they say, "Oh, we're going camping this weekend." I'm like, "Oh, have a great time," blah blah blah. Do you guys camp? Absolutely not. Absolutely 100% no. I don't like the prep. I don't like the this. I don't like the that. I don't like doing all the work that you have to do to set up to go camping, to get there, and then do a bunch of work to set up the stuff, to then sit down and then find peace for a few minutes, and then pack all your crap up and get it back, and then you have to clean it, and that is not for me. And it's and when I kind of have that why I don't camp, they're like, "Yeah, it is a lot of work." If I need to camp, I can go down to the Hyatt and rent a room for the night. That's my camping.
These people who are like type A personalities, where they're running around every single day, burning the candle at both ends, and they feel like that's what they need to do to be like productive and to be valuable as human beings, they go on vacation and they stack their itinerary with all these things to do, and they're running around. They bring the same behavior, the same energy that they have every single day, when and then they never get to rest. And they're like, I need a vacation from the vacation. Well, that's because you were working the entire time.
Right. And for many of us, the just to go on vacation, you have to do so much work in advance to prep your professional calendar, to make sure everything gets done, to make sure everything's covered, and to carve time out. And then it's a bunch of work on the back end, catching up on stuff. That sometimes it's like, is this even worth it?
No, probably not. So it would be more worth it if you have a degree of peace and serenity every single day.
Absolutely.
And when you finally do go on the vacation, you can really just relax, because then you can have more of that throughout the day instead of just like a half hour here, a half hour there. I mean, the half hour here every day is really good. That's important. But then when you get like 8.5 hours of that, or 12 hours of that, even better, just makes the vacation even more robust for you regarding relaxation.
The other when we talk about bringing peace to your life, we can never underscore how important sleep is on a daily basis. People that go all week long and then just say, I'll catch up on sleep on the weekend. Doesn't work like that. First of all, you can't catch up on sleep. I mean, when you're sleep deprived, you're sleep deprived. Now, it's nice to catch up and it's But then you spend up sleeping for 12 hours and wasting your whole weekend sleeping. But anyway, sleep, if there's any magic to mental health, I mean the single most important thing to for mood and mental health, in my opinion, is sleep. A good, predictable sleep pattern, and your brain needs to know what to anticipate. Go to bed around the same time every evening. Doesn't have to be exactly, but around the same time. You can have some modifications on the weekend, obviously, but your brain wants to anticipate because your brain can is working behind the scenes. So if it knows that you're going to go get to bed at 11, fall asleep around 11:30, your brain's planning and it will help you do that. But if you go to bed at 9 one night, 2 a.m. the next night, and then midnight the third night, your brain doesn't know what to expect anymore.
It's not a routine, it's not a habit.
That's not a habit. So if you can create that habit for you, and people say, well, I can't sleep, I have trouble sleeping. Well, yes, that may be the case, but it's partially because your brain doesn't know what to expect. Engage with your brain on helping you get to sleep and predictable sleep patterns. Cut out the screens a half hour in advance, watch your caffeine and all that stuff, alcohol, whatever. Alcohol may help you get to sleep, but it will not keep you asleep. So watch those things. But if there is any magic, it is predictable sleep. And I used to be one of those 4 hour a night guys. I went to bed at midnight and I got up at 4 a.m. I was at work by 6 a.m. every morning. I was one of those guys for a long time. And I finally realized after a medical issue that I cannot sustain this kind of life. This is not this kind of lifestyle is not going to sustain me in the long term, in the long run. So I made a deal with myself that whether I was sleeping or not, I would lay in bed for 8 hours. No screens, no books, no nothing. Just had to lay there. And if I slept, great. And if I didn't, that's just tough luck. And you know what? The first 3 nights were miserable. Absolutely horrible. And then the fourth night, I slept probably 7 hours, and I sleep 7 to 8 hours ever since. And that was 10 years ago. So, your brain will do it. Don't say you can't, because you can.
And if you're absolutely exhausted day in and day out and you crash, if that happens where you have like a really tough day and you're exhausted and you crash, and then you go back to just taking a nice moderate pace and then going to bed at a good time. That's one thing. We all have those days. But if you're doing that every day, when you crash, you're probably not getting the restorative sleep that you need if you're doing that every night. So if you feel like I got to work so hard and you as soon as your head hits the pillow, you're just out, that's not necessarily a good thing. You remember those days in our 20s? Some people have that still in their 40s and 50s, but where you get absolutely smashed, hammered, drunk, and you don't even remember what happened and you pass out and you wake up, you still feel like a sack of crap because you haven't gotten the requisite amount of sleep and recovery. It's not good sleep. So we need to slow down a little bit. Turn the dial down a few clicks. Why do we need to be working as hard as we're working? Is it really to our benefit? I think it's more to our detriment. So if we can slow down a little bit, go a little bit easier, find some peace and serenity each day, get some really good sleep, your life is going to be so much better.
And the stories I hear is everyone, many people are struggling with their work right now. Either their pay is low, and they're having to work a lot, maybe two jobs, to
Yeah.
bring in enough money to afford, because life's expensive right now. Groceries are expensive, gas expensive, insurance,
Yeah.
rent, housing, mortgage, everything is very expensive. So people are either working two jobs or multiple jobs to make ends meet, or if you're in a I guess a more skilled job, the demands that corporate America are putting on you are
Yeah.
much more intense than they ever have been. Big companies are laying off at record rates and they're not rehiring, they're restructuring, which means the people that are there are doing more work.
Yeah.
And I just talk to people that are just like in their 40s, 50s, in their or maybe even early 60s that are just being crushed by the amount of work that's expected of them. And so many people are talking to me about, I got to figure out how I get out of this. How can I retire early? Do I have enough money for that? It's just not worth it.
Yeah. And they're burned out.
Yeah, for sure.
And then you know, because it's happened to me as well, that if you don't do something about it, medically, something is going to happen.
Your body will take care
Emotionally.
of it for you.
Yeah. Yeah, exactly.
And they talk about, salt kills, alcohol kills, which could be true, but they talk about all these things that kill. And the biggest thing that will kill you the fastest is stress.
Stress. Yeah.
And people don't get that. And I was in my younger crazy days. I would say, man, I eat stress. Man, it doesn't bother me at all. It doesn't bother me. I was in very stressful work situations, and I would, nobody could tell that on the inside it was chewing me up. So it was right. I ate it, and it, was rotten from the inside.
Right. We convince ourselves that, oh, I can deal with it. I've got this. No, that's not a problem,
Right.
I'm a superhuman. I'm a
Right.
robot. I'm a machine.
Right.
Nope.
Doesn't work that way.
Yeah.
So, find your peace. What brings you joy? Where is your peace?
Yeah.
And you know what? If you don't know because you haven't had it in a while, that's okay. Don't beat yourself up over it. Figure it out. What did you used to like to do? What would you've always thought about? Like, when I retire, I will do this. Is it
Yeah.
painting? Is it woodwork? Is it reading? I'm back into reading again, and I used to read a ton, probably a book or two a week, at my peak, and I'm back to a book or two a week. So I love reading. I love being outside. Love being on the motorcycle. I can't read while I'm riding very well, but
Yeah, that's a good point. If you were retired or if you didn't have to work, just hypothetically, let's engage with that. What would you want to do with your time? That is probably the things that like bring you peace and joy. And so we need to find a way to do those things, even though you still got to go to work and you still got to perform and do this and that. find a way to engage in those things. And if you really don't know what you would want to do if you were retired or didn't have to work, then listen or ask what other people like to do in their spare time or what gives them peace and joy, and try out those things and see if they take.
Gardening, reading, the getting outside and doing some stuff in nature. What is it? What is it that you want to do with yourself? Maybe you don't have time to volunteer, but a lot of people so go to the animal shelter on the weekend and just check out all the dogs and before they get eaten and pet a few cats. Maybe that'll bring you some joy. Figure it out. Try different things.
Yeah, exactly. Oh yeah, if you animals, pets, we have dogs, and of course just like playing with the dogs and lying with the dogs, snuggling with the dogs, that is my peace right there. We're just relaxing and we just have those little guys, and especially when they're kind of sleepy and snuggly, like that's one of the best things in the world. That's a peaceful place.
I had a big meathead German Shepherd, but she's the best.
She's the best, right?
She wants to play and tug, and she's very strong. She's a sweetheart.
Also, I wanted to mention, because this is somewhat humorous to me, I usually pick up things really quick, but this is something that I was slow with. So this year I decided that every day I was going to do yoga. And in fact, I was going to become a yoga teacher, which I have, and I've stuck to it. I've done it, yoga every single day this year since January 1st till today, which is whatever, 13th, Friday the 13th of September.
Dun,
Woo!
dun, dun, dun.
And it, I love it. I absolutely, I didn't realize how much I would enjoy it. Now I've dabbled with it over the past 20 some odd years here and there. But never as vigorously as I have this year. And this is where the slow part comes in. I was so focused on really trying to get all the poses, down as many as I can do, and to learn the Sanskrit name, and to learn, the placement and the position and the angles. And I was so focused on all that that it didn't become such the relaxing meditative process. And I mean, really, the poses of yoga are to get you to the place where you can finally meditate. And so there was finally a switch that was flipped in my brain where it was like, dude, you don't need to be perfect. You don't need to really get the, bring your head all the way down between your legs in a forward fold type of thing. Like, just do it, just be, and just practice, regardless of where you're at. Like, just the process of doing it. And for some reason, like, that mindset shift enabled me to really enjoy the practice, even though that I'm not that great at it, but it's working towards getting better. So, if you are working towards something to find a sense of peace and serenity in your life, you don't have to be perfect at it. It doesn't have to be, because I've heard people say, well, I don't want to do yoga because it's too hard. I've tried it in the past and like I just can't get the position down, and I, like I was falling and what. Just work at it and you'll get better at it as a consequence of doing it on a routine basis. But it's not about you getting into the actual perfect pose and having the perfect angles and being able to, toss your legs behind your ears or whatever. It's just about the practice of it, and to finally be in that peaceful place where you can stop the fluctuations and turnings of the mind and just finally be.
There's some great introductory yoga you can find on YouTube or that's out there. And the problem that I have talked with people, and I don't try, I mean, I do some yoga, not very often, but I would say maybe once a week. When I get the hankering, but people compare themselves. Well, I can't do it like everybody else. Well, of course not. They've been doing it for 20 years. I would hope that you can't do it as well. So, but just try, practice, get better at it. Do the same introductory routine. Don't go for advanced yoga. Don't go with your friend to, the advanced yoga class. That's not going to be helpful for you. Start
Right.
slow. Work your way up.
My wife is very thin, and like she can fold and bend and do all these kinds of things in yoga, which is great, but I'm 235, like, and lift weights. My muscles are tight. I don't stretch, except for doing the yoga. I'm not going to get into those positions, but it doesn't matter. I'm a whole different person. So don't worry about, you not looking like the instructor or like the person that can fold into a pretzel, like just, or do a headstand or something, Well, like, don't just practice.
Absolutely. So find your peace, whatever it is. What brings you joy?
Yeah.
Find it. Do it.
Every day, something. Do
Every day.
something every day that's just peaceful for you, and you will benefit from it immensely. Just be disciplined about it. You don't have to be motivated nor excited to do that. And maybe at first it would be like, ah, oh, this is just another thing for my stupid mental health, but just do it anyway.
Right. And if you can't figure out what that is, go into a quiet room, close the door, and just breathe for 10 minutes. Do
Yeah.
nothing but sit and breathe. Start there.
That's a good start. Great start.
Mm-hmm.
Thank you for being here. Thanks for listening to us. If you guys have any questions or want to make any comments about the things we're talking about, or if there's something that you'd like for us to talk about, please send your comments and questions to questions@therapyunzipped.com.
All right. Well, thank you for your time today, Tom. Always great to see you.
Thank you. I really appreciate you being here. Thank you guys for listening to us, and stay tuned. We'll be back next week.
Thanks, Tom.